Coming out, there's Stacy, there's Scott. October is Pastor Appreciation Month, and we've put together a little something-something for Scott and Stacy, and Al Graham and Brittany are going to help me with it. Bring that on out here. All right, let's turn it this way. All right, let's uncover this, and I'm going to explain it. It's a little underwhelming when you first see it, but give me a chance to explain. Actually, it's not underwhelming. It's actually amazing, but when you hear what it is, it's really amazing. I think they need some help. Okay, what this is a cross. Remember, a few months ago, we had a small stage over here from our old worship center, and we tore the stage out. When we tore that stage out, I saved the 4x8 sheet of plywood right in the center where Scott stood and preached for all those years. Out of that piece of plywood, we cut it into a cross. Now on this cross, there's 21,197 nails sticking in this cross. Each nail represents a person who has said yes to Jesus since you all started the church. 21,197 nails.
That's so awesome.
Some of you are on this cross. If you've said yes to Jesus through this ministry, you're on this. Some of your wives, some of your children are on this cross. Scott and Stacy, we love you. You have anything to say, Scott?
Man, yeah. Thank y'all so much. You know, for Stacy and I, leading this church has been such a privilege. I feel like Pastor Appreciation ought to be how much we appreciate you guys, not how much you appreciate it, because we feel appreciated.
Absolutely. Every time that y'all have held a baby, every time that you have worked with someone, every time that you have led someone to Christ, every time you've led a small group, I mean, that's where the rubber meets the road. I mean, that's where the real lives change. And so we haven't done this. It's been God working through all of us to do this together.
And I love what Kurt said, because it just means so much that many of you in this room are represented here because your life has changed here. And I, man, that's just the coolest thing. That's the coolest gift I've ever gotten in my life. Amen. I mean, I'm overwhelmed. That is absolutely
Let's
incredible.
Give it up for our pastor and his family one more time. Scott, we love you.
Thank y'all. Yeah. It's awesome.
I don't know where he's going to put it, but we'll find a place for it. Let's say a prayer. If you'll stand to your feet, please. And we're going to pray for Scott and his family, and at the same time pray for our offering, and then we'll be out of the way. We'll worship a little bit more, and then Scott will come and teach. But will you guys join me in, first of all, praying for Scott and his family? Father God, this morning, I thank you for every nail that's on this cross. I thank you for all 21,197 people who gave their life to Jesus through the ministry of this church. I thank you for the Harness family that 16 years ago, they literally sold out to begin this church. In 16 years, God, you've reached thousands of people through them and their ministry. So God, I pray blessings on their family. I pray blessings for Scott and Stacy and their children and their household. God, I pray that every need they have is met in you. And God, I pray that you protect them emotionally and physically and spiritually as we keep pressing forward to see this number doubled in the next few years, because greater things than we can even see or imagine you have in store for us and this church and this ministry. And God, I think for the people who are standing, who are such a part of this story, I think for the people that are represented on this cross, and for people that put nails on this cross when they brought people to the services who said yes to you. God, we love you. Be with this offering so we can keep moving forward and reaching more and more people. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Crazy makers, how to deal with people who drive you crazy.
Well, good morning, that church. How is everybody? Man, it is incredible to be here. What a great day. Thank you guys again. Pastor Appreciation is such a humbling month, because you just see so much that everybody's doing it, and all the things that God has put in place and preparing, and it feels a little awkward taking any like credit for that, but I know that that's not how that was intended, but I just want to say thank y'all for letting me be your pastor, because you let me do that, and that to me is really an honor, and I love what I get to do. I really do. This is incredible. And so I just want to say thank you again for letting me be here, man, really. We are going to drive on into this final week. This is the last week of Crazy Makers. Last week for us to deal with the people who drive you crazy. And it's going to be great. We're going to do some work. We're going to look at some folks. We're going to look at a group of people. We're going to look at religious people. Huh? That's the group of people everybody loves to hate, isn't it? The religious people. Here's what I want to do, though. I want to prepare you, because I don't want you to walk into this message maybe the way that you've walked into these messages over the past few weeks. This is not for you to identify a religious person you know. We all know a religious person, right? And if you don't, I'll introduce you to one before you leave. It's not about identifying that religious person around you, not this message. This message is really more intended for you to be prepared to deal with the religious person who lives in you. If you're given half a chance, you will become religious. The longer you're in church, the greater the danger is of you becoming religious. And so let me explain what religious really means, because I think that's really important. Because you go, wait a second, I thought church, religion, religious, we're being religious now. Is that bad? It is bad. Religion says that there's a practice or a position that you hold that makes you right with God. And we don't believe that, nor does the Bible teach that. We believe that the only way that we can be made right with God is through Jesus alone. And so it's really important for us to know that. Why? Because when we start being religious, we start focusing on performance. And when you start focusing on performance, you start finding a pecking order. You'll find that there will be a group of people who think they're better than somebody else because they did more than somebody else. It's dangerous, it's toxic, and it's the very thing that Jesus confronts over and over and over in the New Testament. Of all the people that Jesus has the least amount of patience with, I would say has the least amount of patience with the religious crowd. He can hang out with prostitutes, and he can hang out with the malcontents of his community, but he really struggles not correcting the religious people, and that's one of the things we're going to see today. So here's what I want you to do. As much as it's going to be tempting as we go through this for you to think of that one religious kind of whack job person that you know and go, yeah, that's her, and she needs to be here to hear this, and da-da-da, I want you to know that God didn't bring you here to listen for somebody else. God brought you here to listen for you. And if you're not careful, and if I'm not careful, given to our own devices, we'll become just as religious as the next person. We'll become just as judgmental. We'll become just as ungrateful as the rest. And so we're not going to do that, right? That's not where we're going to be, because we don't want to be religious. We want to be grateful. We want to lean into Jesus, and we want to point all fingers towards him and say, it's about the Lord. It's not about me. It's not about a pecking order. It's not about someone being more spiritual or someone being less spiritual than somebody else. It's about Christ and exalting him and exalting God. And so that's what we're going to look at as we kind of go through this. And so let me give you the setting. This is Luke chapter 7, and I'm going to introduce you in a moment to a prostitute, and she's incredible, by the way. Sounds kind of weird coming from your pastor, but it's true. Jesus has been invited to a party, all right? He's been invited to a party that's being hosted by a man named Simon. Simon is a Pharisee. This party isn't just any party. It's one of those parties that you go to that everybody there is really religious. Everybody there is kind of famous in their own eyes. And it's one of these parties where it's filled with people who love to one-up the other people. Do you ever have those kind of folks? Do you ever run into those kind of people that no matter what you say, you know, like you say, well, my daughter, she just had our first grandbaby, and we're so excited. And they're like, yeah, well, my daughter just, you know, gave birth to a litter, you know, or whatever. They got, you know what I mean? I mean, they've just got this like, theirs is always bigger. They got something greater that's happening. You know, you caught a fish, they caught a whale. You know, you got a job, they got, you know, given a country. I don't know, something. But they're always, that's what this party would have been. And I would dare say that I don't know this for sure. I would be putting words in God's mouth. But what I would say is this. I would imagine that Jesus didn't really want to go. It may have been one of those moments where the Father said, this, you got to be there. And he goes to this thing. Because who wants to go to those events? Who wants to go to an event where it's filled with people that are all filled with themselves? Nobody does, but that's where Jesus is. And he shows up. And so what I want to do is I want to show you the comparison and contrast that God gives between this very humble woman who's a prostitute and this group of people who are highly religious who think they've got it, you know, going on. And so let's look at that together. Luke chapter 7, verses 37. They're at the party, okay? Jesus has come in. People are like, oh, hey, yo. and they just keep on going with what they've got going. Luke chapter 7, verse 37. When a certain immoral woman from the city heard he was eating there, she brought a beautiful alabaster jar filled with expensive perfume. Now, let me push pause for a second and just kind of tell you something that was a trend that was happening in Jesus' community. Over and over, for whatever reason, it happens at least three different times in the New Testament, women come and as an act of worship, they pour onto Jesus this oil that has a fragrance. This was a very valuable thing to this first century community. It was very valuable. Water was scarce in this area, and so to smell good, you didn't always bathe, because there wasn't water for that. What you would do very often is you would try to put some oil on and hope that would sort of make you smell better for a little bit. And I know that sounds kind of yucky, but here's what I'm going to say. That oil was very valuable in their community. It was a very expensive thing. It would have been especially very valuable for a prostitute, because you may not get chosen if you don't smell good. And I know that sounds sad, but that's the reality. But this woman comes, and oftentimes this happens the same way. At another event, Jesus' feet are anointed with oil. And then at another time, a lady anoints his head with oil. She pours this perfume on Jesus' head. At this instance, this woman is going to pour it on his feet. And let's read it together. And she brought a very beautiful alabaster jar filled with expensive perfume. Then she knelt behind him at his feet, weeping. Her tears fell on his feet, and she wiped them off with her hair. Then she kept kissing his feet and putting perfume on them. It's an interesting story, and I want to just start off by asking a simple question. Reading what we've read so far, and by the way, there's no more information later about this. What's the lady's name? You know why you don't know? It's because it's not mentioned. But you know what is mentioned? Her reputation. That's the only thing she's known by. We don't know what her name is. Her name could have been Judy. It could have been Jill. It could have been anything. But we don't know her name. But you know what we know? We know what she's done. We know her history. Let me just say this. Among religious people, what's more important to them is who you are and what you've done. When it comes to Jesus, it has more to do with where is your heart. Matter of fact, this is the first point. If you're taking notes, write this down. Praising God isn't about the position of the person. It's about the position of your heart. And I want to put this in front of you today, because I don't know if you know the opportunity that you have and how important that it is. Today, you have this incredible opportunity to worship God. That's a big deal. Incidentally, you might look at people like Billy Graham or some great pastor or some great servant somewhere, and you may go, wow, they could worship God better than me. Can I tell you something? No one can love God better than you. No one can. And you know what? Loving God and worshiping God has nothing to do with your position, at least what position you hold in life. It has everything to do with the position of your heart. Some of you are sitting in this room right now, and you're looking back and you're rewinding the tape, and you look back at yesterday and you did something last night you shouldn't have. Or maybe you did something yesterday you shouldn't have. Or maybe on Friday you blew it. Or maybe somewhere through the week you messed things up and you messed your life up. You blew some things up, some things that you knew you shouldn't have compromised, you did. And you're sitting here today, and here's the problem. You're going, well, I can't really worship God today, because you feel like there has to be mileage between your mess and your worship. But I want you to know, this woman, we don't know this, but this woman could have come straight from turning a trick. But that's not what's important. You know what's important? I just made some of you uncomfortable. I watched your faces. Did he say trick? Yeah. It's the truth. She could have. But you know what's important right now is that she's turned and she's put our life in God's hands. Right at that moment. Listen, if you begin to believe that somehow you've got to live right for a while before you can spend time with God, you're going to blow your life up and you're going to miss the point of the cross. The point of Jesus coming and dying for you and doing something for you that you couldn't do for yourself should tell you that it doesn't matter the length of time between my last mess up and this moment with God. Doesn't matter. What matters is that you need to take advantage of this moment. This is what you have. This is the moment you have to worship God. This woman, she may not have known very much about Jesus, but she knew at this moment in time, she had a chance to worship him, and she took advantage of it. I wonder how many people walk in and out of church, how many people walk in and out of their life. I wonder how many people spend how many days going through their days, never really stopping and taking advantage of the opportunity to worship God. For whatever reason, you have a chance to worship God. This woman had a chance and she took advantage of it. And you're going to see that God responds to it, and you're going to see her be blessed. But I want you to notice it's her position that's important. Notice how she positions herself with Jesus. It says this, then she knelt behind him. Why would she kneel behind him? Can I tell you why? because she didn't want him to see her. She didn't want him to look at her. You want to know why? Because she didn't feel worthy. She's an immoral woman. No one knows her name because it's not important. What's important is we know your history. We know your failures. We know your rap sheet. That's what we know. And you know what? I'm not worthy to stand in front of Jesus. This is God's son. This is God in the flesh. So I'm going to come up behind him and I'm going to kneel behind him because I don't want him to look at me. Because if he looked at me, he would know who I am. And I'm a mess and I'm unworthy. And goes on, she knelt behind him at his feet. Notice where she is. She's on her knees. She's behind him at his feet on her knees with her head down, and she's not even going to look up her position. Now, at the same time in the room, there's this group of religious people who think that they've got it made. They think they've got it right. They think they've done all the stuff that they're supposed to, and they're walking around, and they would wear a certain wardrobe, by the way. They would have these prayer shawls that they would wear, and everybody's walking around. They're talking about their accomplishments. They're talking about all the things they've done and the good thing. They're quoting scripture. They're telling you everything about themselves, and they are standing in the presence of God's son. Yet there's an immoral woman, a woman who doesn't have it together, a woman who's messed it up, a woman who's dirty, but she's in the right spot. Let me tell you this, your position, the position of your heart has everything to do with how God moves on your behalf. So often we as Americans think somebody owes us something. We come to God as if we're giving him orders. We speak to God as if God answers to us. Let me just tell you something. The reason why we bow before God to pray is to remind us physically where we should be spiritually. You get on your knees actually so that you'll be reminded that spiritually you should be on your knees. Why? Because he is God and I am not. And I need to be reminded of that. Prayer is a demonstration that there's someone greater than me. There's someone who is more control than me. This woman puts herself in a spot and she's saying this by the way she approaches Jesus. I'm less and you're Lord. You're the Lord. And man, he's going to bless her for it. Where's your position? How are you positioned with God? Because your worship is going to be worthwhile if you're positioned where you should be. And God answers that and he blesses it. Let me give you a second thing to consider. Wherever there's worship, there will also be whispering. Because there's only two groups of people when it comes to worship. There's worshipers and there's whisperers. There's those who see Christ for who he is and they humble themselves before God and they say, I'm less, you are Lord. I worship you. Then there's another group of people that do not see God as they should. But the moment you're around somebody and they're worshiping and you're not willing to, it makes you feel really uncomfortable. When people are sold out to something and you're not, it makes you feel really uncomfortable. It makes you feel weird. And so you know what you're going to do? Either you're going to bring yourself in a line and you're going to worship or you're going to whisper. You're going to see Christ or you're going to see others and you're going to criticize. And it happens in every church. In every church, there's worshipers. Those who will humble themselves before God, those who will serve God, those who will see God for who he is, and you'll have whisperers, those who will talk about him. Did you see her? What does she think she's doing? So silly. She thinks she's Miss Super Christian. Look at her over there trying to do this and that. And worshipers or whisperers? Where are you? This woman, she may not have been the best person. She may have not have been the person you set your moral compass by, but you know what she was? She was a worshiper. She knew the position that Jesus had to be in her life, and she put him there, and it's an incredible thing. See, in religious circles, when you're very religious, there's only two kinds of people around you. There's those who are better than you are, maybe they've done more than you have, or those that are worse than you are. And that's what you look for. You look at the people that are worse than you, you go, oh, I'm better than her. I'm better than him. You know, because he's divorced. Oh, you know her. You remember she had that little drug issue, you know? Or there they are. Yeah, their kids, look at their kids. They're rotten. So therefore, you know, worse than us. I'm glad we're not like them. You'll hear statements like that among religious people. Aren't you glad you're not married to her? Your naive husband will say to you. No. And so there's the worse and then there's the better. But when Jesus comes along, you know what he does? He adds value to every person. Therefore, Jesus became competition to religion. Because if religion wasn't about a pecking order, what were they going to have? Jesus comes along and says, no, wait just a second. Even the prostitutes mean something to me. Even the worst of community are valuable to me. Then all of a sudden, the playing field's leveled. It's not about what you've done for God. It's actually about what God has done for you. It's a life lived of gratitude, not a life lived in arrogance and posturing ourselves, hoping that others might see something else that's really not there. Wherever there's worship, there will also be whispering. Are you a worshiper? Or are you a whisperer? Let me give you a third thing to consider. Is worship makes Jesus visible for who he is. Jesus walks into this party. He just comes in. Now remember, this is God in street clothes. He walks in and nobody recognizes him. Just so you'll know, so often, you know what God does? He shows up in street clothes. I want you to know something about God. Very seldom does God elevate himself and bring glory to himself. God wants people to bring glory to him. That's what he does. The Bible says concerning Jesus, there was nothing about his physical appearance that would attract us to him. Jesus just was an ordinary guy. His name wasn't extraordinary. That's a common name. He's a common guy. It would take people pointing him out. At this party, Jesus walked in. There was no fanfare. He didn't even get the common courtesy of a feet washing, which was characteristic of people who visited your house back then. Again, there was no real baths. Not enough water for that. So when you came in, if you came into my house and you were my guest, I would provide water by the door for you to wash your feet. You want to know why? Because you're wearing sandal feet and it's like 100 degrees outside. And you've been in them sandals a long time. And we're wanting to enjoy a meal, and we can't because your feet are funkier than a monkey, all right? So you're going to have to put some scrubberoo on that thing, or you're going to make me cough up my hors d'oeuvre. So you got to clean it up. But when Jesus comes in, they don't even offer him anything to wash his feet, not at this party. They don't offer him oil for his head so he'll smell good. They don't offer him a kiss and a greeting that says, hey, I'm glad you're here. Nothing. He's treated as common. Listen to me. God remains common wherever people treat him as common. Can I talk to you parents for a second? One of the biggest mistakes that you make as parents is you treat God as common. You want your kids later to make good moral decisions. You want your kids later to be upstanding people. You want your kids later, you want their lives to count. Let me ask you something. Can they see your love for God in the life that you live? Because if they can't see it in you, you're not elevating God where they can see him for who he really is. Worship says God is important. Several years ago, we were on a duck hunt. And we'd come out to eat breakfast at a hole-in-the-wall restaurant. It was awesome, a great place. And we're sitting there eating breakfast, and this crowd of guys come in, and they sit down on a table next to us. And the guy that's one of the guys that's with us on this hunt, he said, man, do you know who that is? I said, I got no idea. He said, man, he starts naming off these. He's name-dropping left and right. That's so-and-so. That's Senator so-and-so. That's Congressman so-and-so. And that's so-and-so, the attorney. And that's so-and-so. That's the guy that you remember. He was the one who saw. And he just goes through this list of stuff. And to tell you how impressed I was by it, I can't remember a single person's name that he told me, which I probably should. That's probably important information, but I'm just not into that. But as he sat there, he was completely beside himself, kind of anxious about, he said, I cannot believe we're eating breakfast next to him. He's trying to do hidden pictures, you know, with his camera to send to his buddies. The way he was making over these people, it made me kind of straighten up, and I'm knocking dirt off my shirt. I'm like, you know, my hair, I'm trying to get my hat on a little more straight because I didn't know who they are. But because he saw them as being somebody, it made me feel like they were somebody. Do you understand? See, when we worship Jesus, people begin to see him for who he is. You know why this woman is such a big deal to this event? It's because she sees Jesus for who he is. She's knelt behind him. She's anointing him feet. She's making a sacrifice by putting this perfume. She's using her hair to wipe his feet. That means her hair is going to be filthy, nasty when she's finished. Incidentally, 2 Corinthians says a woman's hair is her glory. And you're going to have a hint as to what this woman knows. She knows that God desires and deserves glory. She's given him glory. When you worship God, you give him glory. When you worship God, you tell others, you say, oh, wait a second, that's Jesus. That's Jesus. Several years ago, we had a young lady in our student ministry stuff. She was the cheer captain at one of the local schools. And she's a worshiper, loves God. And I remember all the other students that looked up to her, they kind of idolized her. And she worshiped Jesus. She was an amazing follower of God. And so many of the kids, I was having a conversation with one of them and says, man, I just can't believe that. So I won't tell you who it is. So-and-so's here because, man, you know, she's the most popular girl on campus and she worships Jesus. And I knew if she worships Jesus that I need to probably do the same thing. See, the moment you begin to worship Christ, the people around you see him for who he is. So if I were to pool your family in order to ask your kids this question, hey, how does mommy see Jesus? How important is Jesus to mommy? What do you think your kids would say? If I were to ask your neighbors and say, hey, tell me how important is Jesus to this family, what would they say? Your coworkers, if I said, hey, how important is Jesus to so-and-so? How important is he? What would they say? See, worship tells everybody around you that Jesus is valuable. It says, this is God's son. This woman gives God glory. Now, we live in a time where there is absolutely no honor. You understand me? No honor. You want to know why our country's in such a mess? I'll tell you why. Because there's no honor in our country anymore. We don't honor anybody. We criticize everybody and we think we're justified. We think if somebody's on the opposite side of even an issue or something silly, you think you have the right to destroy them in any way that you can. You don't. And by the way, the less honor that we have in our community, the less our community will be a community. We can criticize our president. You go, man, I don't like him, so I can say anything I want to. Can I tell you something? There was a time once in our history that the office of presidency deserved respect and was honored, and it should still be that way. You want honorable men and women to be the president of this country? Then make the office of presidency an honorable position. We make it that, not politics. We make it that. We should honor people. We don't honor our parents. We don't honor our coworkers. We don't honor our bosses. We don't honor our job. We honor nobody. And most importantly, and where this started, is we stopped honoring God. We stopped honoring him in our schools. We stopped honoring him in our pledges. We stopped honoring, most importantly, we stopped honoring him in our homes. And the moment that we begin to treat God as common, everything else changes. And you get nothing but a mess after that. That's what you get. And that's where we are. Let me show you how important glory is to God. If I were to ask you this question, if I were to say, hey, why did Jesus die on the cross? Most of you who've been in church for any period of time, you would say, well, Jesus died on the cross because of my sins or for my sins. Is that true? I would say, absolutely, that's true. But that's not the first motivating factor for God coming and dying on a cross for you. Did you know that? That's not the first factor. The first factor is this: Jesus died on a cross for God's glory. That's why he died on the cross. You say, well, what do you mean? Here's what I mean. God loved us so much that he wanted a relationship with us, but he couldn't have a relationship with us. You want to know why? Because we're broken and messed up and sinful. The perfection of God could not cohabitate with the mess of mankind. Couldn't. But God loved us so much. And if God were to wink at you and say, it's okay, you can live any way you want to, it doesn't matter to me, who cares? There'll be no fee, there's no justice, who cares? Just come on in, everything will be fine. Then God loses his glory. And when God loses his glory, he's no longer God. And God refuses to not be God. So for God to save his glory and have a relationship with you, he sent his son Jesus to take your place. And then justice was served, and the glory and the honor of God was preserved. Do you understand? So glory to God is really, really important. Glory to God was so important that God would let his own son die for it. That's how important it is. And let me show you in the Old Testament how important glory is to God. In 1 Chronicles chapter 13, David is king. Israel has reestablished her borders and her kingdom is reestablished. And David says, you know what? Now that we're reestablished, we need to go get the Ark of the Covenant. The Ark of the Covenant was a big, heavy, golden and wooden box that really represented the presence of God. It was an object lesson for Israel. And God says, wherever this box is, just know that that's me. I'm wherever this box is. He's just trying to help them understand, how do you handle the glory of God? How should we handle God? How should we talk to God? How should we treat God when he's in our presence? And he's trying to give them this object lesson. And so he says, okay, so how you handle this box is the same as handling me. Well, there came a point in Israel's history where David said, you know what, let's do, King David says, let's go get the Ark of the Covenant. Because wherever that box is where God is. Wherever God is, everything is blessed. And we want to be blessed, so let's go get God and let's bring him back to Israel. They said, sounds like a plan, but the box is heavy. So here's what let's do. Let's get a wagon and let's go over there and let's get God. And let's put him in a wagon and let's bring him back, you know, to Israel. Sounds like a good plan, real practical. No one hurts their back. Seems like a good idea. And so they go to get the Ark of the Covenant, or they go to get God, and they bring him back. Now here's what happens. David sends Jethro and Bobby Don, and they go to get God. And they throw God up in the back of this wagon, and they don't put a ratchet strap on him, and they're just kind of bringing him back, and the wagon's flopping around, and the box is about to fall out the back like you're throwing a piece of junk in the back of your S10 pickup truck, okay? And at one point, here's where we take it up, it says, and the oxen stumbled. They didn't have good oxes. The ox kind of stumbles, and when it does, Uzziah reaches out his hand to steady. The ark almost falls out the back of the bed of the pickup truck, if you will. And one of the guys, Bobby Don, we'll call him Uzziah, he reaches out his hand and stops it. And they almost make a joke. God almost fell out on the ground. How funny that is. Here's what happens. Listen. Then the Lord's anger was aroused against Uzziah, and he struck him dead because he laid his hand on the ark. We live in an age where we think we can treat God any way that we want to. And I want you to understand, you cannot. You cannot. God requires glory whether you give it or not. You will either be blessed by God's glory or you'll be crushed under the weight of it. The word glory literally means heavy, the heaviness of God. And so God strikes Uzziah dead. Now listen what happened. So Uzziah died there in the presence of God. 1 Chronicles 13:12. King David hears about it. Here's what happens. David was now afraid of God. Good. And he asked, how can I ever bring the ark of God back under my care? That would have been a good question to ask before you sent Bobby Don and Uzziah out there with their S10 pickup truck that's only running on two cylinders to pick God up. You should have probably asked that question on the front end, because one of the things you would learn if you'd gone to the Levites, which were the people of God, and said, how do we transport the Ark of the Covenant? They would have said, oh, that's easy. On either side of this box, there's slots, and poles are to be slid to those slots. And then God's people, remember, this box is an object lesson. God's not contained in a box. You know that, right? It's an object lesson. And those poles are slid in. And then the Levites, who are God's people, are to take those poles and they're to lift them up. And they're going to put this big heavy box on their shoulders. And they will walk and march and worship as they carry God back into Israel. Mark this down. Here's your object lesson. The presence of God is always ushered in on the shoulders of his people. Always. You know why God's not in your house, sir? It's because he's not being shouldered in on your shoulders. You know why God is not in your school, ma'am, son, sir? It's because you're not carrying him in on your shoulders. You know why God's not in your workplace? Because you're not ushering him in on your shoulders. In this event, one prostitute knows more about the presence of God than every religious person at this party. She knows that if God is going to be visible, he will be carried on the shoulders of his people. Do you bring the glory of God with you? Are you willing to support the weightiness of God? It was easier to carry God around in a wagon. And many of us, that's what we do with God. God is a God of convenience for you. But I want you to know, worship always includes sacrifice on your behalf. Worship always includes you suffering at some level so that God might be visible. This woman saw it. Worship makes Jesus visible for who he is. Because when you and I worship and we sacrifice for God, we tell the world around us, he is worthy. He's worthy. Let me give you a fourth thing. Write this down. Worship needs no words. I want to ask you this question because we haven't read the entire story, but I want to challenge you if you go home to read this story. And I want to ask you this simple question when you do. How many words did she use? This prostitute, how many things did she say? Give me one quote from her. Give me one little step. Because, you know, we talk about worship today. You know what I'll say? It's singing. Can singing be worship? Absolutely it can. This woman never sings a song, and she never says a word, but her worship moves God to do something on her behalf. Three things she does. Write this down. Number one, she bowed before him. She demonstrates her humility. She got on her knees, and she said, you're Lord. I'm less. I mean, she has this humility about her. The second thing is she has a heart. She cried. Simple question. When was the last time you had a moment with God that brought you to tears? When was the last time you had a moment with God that brought you to laughter? When was the last time you were just so overwhelmingly grateful for something God had done or something that God means to you in your life? When was the last time? I think for many of us, it's just too long. We're so busy. We got stuff going on, important things. You know, this party, they had important things going on. They had to be telling stories of when they'd done something great, but God walked in the door. If God walked in the door of your life, would he even get a standing ovation? Would he get any applause? Would there be a pause in your agenda or your to-do list to notice, hey, God just showed up? Or would you just keep on going and the glory of God would be treated as common. It's a big deal. She honored as well. She sacrificed for him. This perfume meant one thing about her. She probably wouldn't be a prostitute anymore. You want to know why? Because she wouldn't smell good anymore. But she made sure he smelled good. She sacrificed for him. He gave her something she had to have, and she gave him something he wanted. Let me tell you this about God. You can't give God anything he needs, but you can give him things that he wants. So you can't give God anything he can't get for himself except for your heart. The one thing he will not take possession of by force is your heart. He protects your freedom to say no to him, but that's the one thing he really wants. This woman gave him what he wanted, and he gave her what she needed. Listen to this verse, Luke 7:47. I tell you, her sins, they are many. Did you notice how God didn't whitewash over the mess that this girl was in? He didn't say, oh, it's not her fault. She had a bad upbringing. She had some terrible parents. And you know, she just fell into prostitution. And just really, she was a victim of this whole thing. You notice he didn't say that? No, he says, no, she's jacked up. I don't want you to know about it. Tell you, her sins, they are many, have been, what's that word? Oh, that's a beautiful word, isn't it? If you knew the liberty of what it feels like to no longer carry the burden of your messes, you would never turn away from God. To be forgiven. She was forgiven. He says, her sins, they are many, have been forgiven. So she has shown me what? A lot of love. You know why we don't love God and sacrifice and serve God? Is because we think we deserve what God has given us. We think we've earned. See, religion says, I've earned it. When Friday comes around and you go get your paycheck, do you get it from your employer and go, oh, I just want to tell you how much I thank you so much for giving this to me. I don't deserve it. No, you go, I work for that. It should have $100 more on there than that. Are you kidding me? I got to work with these people. I should get a bonus per diem for having to deal with these folks, right? No, you don't think, because you believe you've earned it. You have earned it. Listen to me. The religious people believe that the goodness of God is the result of their hard work. But the Bible teaches us, and some of us get it, that what God gives us is not the result of our hard work. It's the reward that we don't deserve. And when you've been given something you don't deserve, something good, you have incredible gratitude. And that's what she has. I tell you, her sins, they are many, have been forgiven. So she has shown me much love, but a person who is forgiven little shows only a little love. So does your life show lots of love towards God? If we took a poll and we polled the people around you, would they say, wow, she really loves God? I know God and how great he is because of the way she lives her life. Would they be able to say that? One prostitute among all these pastors is the only one that really saw the value of Jesus. I want you to know, most of the time the crowd doesn't get it. Only a few. But I'm going to say this, be the few. Maybe just the one. Maybe be just the one in your classroom for young people. Maybe just the one that loves God. Maybe at your workplace, be the one. Don't look for a workplace that has nothing but Christians working in it. Be the Christian in your workplace. Be the one in your house. Maybe your mom and dad, maybe you're the kid and your mom and dad don't get it. Be the one who loves God. Because let me tell you something, every time you worship God, you reveal him for who he is, and every time we reveal Jesus for who he is, things change. Things change. I probably wouldn't say this under any other terms, but I'd say it in these terms. Be like this prostitute. You can pattern your life after this prostitute, all right? That's not good pastoral advice most of the time, but it's good here. It's good here. She's the only one that got it. She really is. She really is. Let's take a second. Let's meet with God for a minute, and let's try to determine where our life is. Where are we headed? So if you would, just bow your heads with me. Nobody looking around for just a second. Let's take a moment, and let's consider a couple things. Has my position with God put me in a place where I'm kneeling before him, where I'm worshiping him with my life? Do I see him for who he truly is? Am I approaching him with humility? Am I a worshiper in the church? Or am I a whisperer? Am I good at gossip? A lot better than I am at loving God. The people around me, do they see Jesus for who he is because of the way that I live my life? Can Can I worship with no words? Do my actions say that God means something to me? And He should. For some of us, we're sitting here and we probably have an inventory of things. We go, wow, you know what? I've been missing it. This is a great day to worship God because today you can recognize it. Maybe you just left. Maybe just hours ago, you left the mess of your life and you walked into this room and you didn't realize you were going to be met with God. This prostitute just heard that Jesus was at that house. I don't know that she left to take a shower. I don't know that she went to clean up or change. I know this. She came straight to where He was and she bowed at His feet. And you know what He did? He forgave her. He lifted her and He sent her away as a brand new person. Can I tell you something? God is meeting with some of you here even right now. And if you will give your life to Him, will you recognize Him for who He is and put your life in His hands, He will forgive you, He will lift you, and He will change your life. He'll change your life. If you're ready for that, why don't you pray with me? Right here, right in this seat, right now. You say, man, I'm not ready. Yeah, you are. You're ready. If God has spoken to you, if you've been moved in this, it's time for you to do something. It's time to take God up for what He's asking of you. If that's you, pray with me. For some of you, for the very first time, you're going to put your life in God's hands. You're going to give Him control of you. Let me pray for you right now. Father, I pray for those in this room. I pray for those who first and foremost need to give You control of their life. They've never done that. I pray, Lord, that they will surrender their life to You, Jesus. That they will confess You as Savior and Lord. And they will give You control. Others in this room, God, I pray for them, Lord, that have not lived a lifestyle of worship, that they will, God, so that the people around them, their kids, their family, their friends, their schoolmates, their neighbors will see Jesus for who You really are. God, may we steer clear of being religious. Instead, God, may we be the kind of people that demonstrate how good You are, so that others might know You and be set free as well. God, I pray for this group of people. May they leave this place today encouraged, having had the moment with You, and changed because they've put their life in Your hands, and charged up to go out into this world and to make a difference in the world that they live in for Your glory. God, we love You and we praise You. We offer this prayer. It is in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.